You know, I say this every week, but this is one of those tracks that you can just go round and round and round and round and round on. Hi guys, how you doing? Nick Jennison, Guitar Interactive Magazine, GI+. It's Monday. We're doing the thing that we do on Mondays, which is hang out and talk about the guitar. And today, excited to tell you that we're discussing one of my absolute favourite players of probably all time, I would say, Richie Kotzen. Now, you guys probably knew this already because my man Richie is... Oh, what a great guitar player, like once-in-a-lifetime kind of talent. He was one of those players that was kind of a cornerstone for me in terms of, or I guess kind of a pivotal moment for me in terms of, you know, my development as a player. When I first heard Bootlegged in Brazil, first time I ever heard Richie Kotzen, man, honestly, right, the top of my head came off. It was quite something. So we're going to be talking about that stuff today. Of course, this stream is also brought to you by our good friends at Tech 21, who have supplied the tone for this evening. Check this out. We've got the Richie Kotzen Flyrig Mark II, which you can check a review out of in a previous edition of Guitar Interactive Magazine. We'll get some links to that posted in the comments. It's a really cool pedal. We're running that into the Super Kraken today, set fairly clean. I'll show you the tones in just a moment. Great sounding wee little pedal. I'm using just the Sounds amp and the OMG overdrive section for this, but all sorts of wonderful effects on there. There's delay, reverb, there's a compressor and a boost. You know, you can check that out in the full review. But if you're just joining us for the first time, I'm going to curtail my excitement and I'm going to welcome you to our stream because, hey, it's Monday. As you guys can probably tell, I've been out in the sun. This slight redness is going to turn into hopefully a glorious tan fairly soon. It's a wonderful day here in the UK. It's Bank Holiday Monday. We've all been out, we've had a lovely time, and now we're back in and we're ready to play some guitar. So if you're joining us for the first time, welcome. It is great to have you. If you're one of our returning streamers, hey, welcome back. It's great to have you too. We love doing these streams. Always gives me a kick, and it's great when we get to take a look at an artist that I'm a huge fan of, like we get to do today. So very, very cool. I think we're in for a good time. So first of all, a couple of ways you can help us keep the lights on, metaphorically and literally, because I've been having some trouble with my backlights over the last few streams, I'm sure you guys remember. You can do the following. You can give us a thumbs up on whatever platform you happen to be watching on. Say, for example, it's YouTube, you can give us a thumbs up. If it's Facebook, heart emojis are very, very welcome. We like those on Facebook. That's cool. Whatever you're watching on, give us a thumbs up. You can also share this with your guitar playing friends. We'd like to get this out to as many guitar players as humanly possible. So if you want to give this a share with a guitar player who you think you get a kick out of what we're doing today, man, that'd be great. That'd be really, really cool. Costs nothing. Helps us out a ton. Also, you can do the following. You can go to GI+, the URL is down here. You can go to guitarinteractivemagazine.com/GI-plus, where you can get more guitar lessons, such as the one we're looking at today. We also have tech sessions covering all manner of artists, from the likes of Steve Vai, through to Dave Gilmour, through to David Gilmour, rather, my mistake, through to, we even have an Adrian Smith one, which is quite interesting, or an Iron Maiden one as well. So if you guys are into the flip side of Richie's Smith-Kotzen collaboration, you can go check that out at the link down below. You can also go and check out the latest edition of Guitar Interactive Magazine, and you can check out our YouTube channel where you'll find all manner of gear reviews, interviews, free backing tracks. Speaking of interviews, I want to take a quick second and show you this. We've got a great interview that's dropped very recently with Wolfgang Van Halen from Chief Editor-in-Chief Jonathan Graham, who does a whole lot of our interviews. I'm sure you guys are familiar. It's a great interview. John's interviews are always fantastic, but this is a really, really good one. I wanted to pull this snippet out and show you because this is really quite cool. Check this out.
It was the one moment that I recorded on the album with my dad's original Frankenstein guitar, and not just the guitar, but also the original Marshall head that he used for the original Van Halen albums, and one of the original cabs. So it was basically everything he used for those original classic albums.
Wow, okay.
And you can hear that on certain bends. You know, it's kind of crazy. There's certain notes where it's like, wow, that literally sounds like Van Halen 1. It's crazy.
So you can go and check that full interview at the links that are going to be in the comments down below, or you can go to the Guitar Interactive YouTube channel, where I assume you're watching this because that's where most of our watchers are, and you can go and find that interview, watch it in full after this stream. It's great. Definitely, definitely worth your time, right? And of course, you should check out the new album when it's available. I've heard little bits of it. It is fabulous. I mean, what else do we expect, right? It's Wolfgang Van Halen. He is the man. So anyway, listen, before we get too deep into the meat of today's session, just want to take a quick second and touch base with our stream. So first of all, here's a link right down here where you can go and check out the new interview. Bookmark that. You're going to need that a little bit later on. But let's see how everybody's getting on. So first of all, our friend Marcin is in with all of the rock hands. Marcin is not with us this evening, which means the stream is not a real stream. We have to cancel. Stream's over, guys, right? Forget it. We're going to do it again another time. Marcin is one of, if you're watching for the first time, he's one of our regular streamers. He's always the first person here. But today, not so much, right? He's off with his band, taking photos of himself, looking like a rock star because you need photos to promote your band. So, man, looking forward to seeing those photos, looking forward to hearing hopefully some recordings of your band soon. That'd be great, man. Very, very cool indeed. Cowcat, that does in fact mean you're the first one here. Sacred Godslayer says, hi, guys. Hi, Nick. Have fun, Marcin. I'll echo that. Have fun, Marcin. Absolutely. Friend Crankatom is tuning in. Hi, everyone. Please, what am I trying to say? Hi, everyone. Looking very much forward to what's about to come. Apparently, I can't read. Richie Kotzen is one of my favorite players. I totally agree, right? Richie is one of my top influences, right? Huge. Cowcat says, the best arcade interview ever is on Pete Thorne's channel. That's a great interview. I totally agree, right? Great interview. Very insightful, too, which is really, really cool. And Pete's a great guy and a great player, too. Keith MOF says, hi, Nick. Hi, everyone, on this warm, sunny evening. It's a beautiful evening, let me tell you. Right, if I could do this from my garden, I would. David Yates is in the house. David, I hope the hands are treating you well. I know you've been having some bother with them lately. I'm glad to hear that you've been on the road to recovery. I've just had a little read further down. I know you're resting your hands up today. I think that's probably a good move. You should, you know, play within your tolerances. If you can play, brilliant. If you feel like you need to rest, don't worry, it's going to be there when you get back. Timothy Appling is in the house, says, good afternoon, Nick and GI guys. It's Memorial Day here in the States. Coming to see some local bands playing outdoors at a barbecue party here in town after this session, which has reminded me that I, in my ignorance, have forgot to wish all of our American friends Happy Memorial Day. Man, Happy Memorial Day to you guys. Yeah, thanks for tuning in. If you're watching, if you're going somewhere to celebrate, have a great day. You know, it's Bank Holiday Monday here in the UK. Not quite the same thing, but, you know, we get a holiday, which is pretty cool. PJ is in the house, with pink hand waving emoji. I'm seeing what I'm seeing. It's hi, Nick and everyone, hand pink waving. It's great to see you, man. Thanks for joining us. We got some questions about David Yates' hands, recurring thing in the stream. We'll get to that in a little bit. Timothy Appling says, Marcin, that sounds great, Marcin. A picture of your band and a list of songs is required to play gigs in most places here. Have a great week. It is too here. It is here too, Rob. Same deal, you know, you need a picture, you need a set list, so, you know, you got to go and do these things if you're going to play in a band. Kim is in the house. Kim's the big boss. Hey, Kim, it's great to see you. I'm sure I'll speak to you later on this week. Got lots of exciting things to chat about. Steve McDee is in the house, says, hi, guys, just put a set of nanowebs on my Strat. I think I prefer the OptoWebs, just trying everything. I'm kind of with you there, man. I think the OptoWebs are the one for me. We're talking about Elixir strings here. I like the lighter coating, but hey, some people get on really well with the thicker coating too. It definitely feels a little slicker for me with quite dry hands. I feel like I slide off the thicker coating, but the OptoWeb feels just about right. Larry Warren's in the house. Greetings from the West. Larry, it is great to see you. Thanks for coming on board. Mark McNish is here. Says, hello, everyone. Only recently taking some interest in Richie Kotzen. Excited for the stream today. Man, I'm excited too. So we've got a question coming in, which I want to know from you guys. What are some of your favorite guitar moments from Richie's career so far? Jonathan says, I think the album What Is could be top of my list. That's a great album. I feel like for me, honestly, and I don't know if this is just because it's the first one that I came across, but for me, like, the definitive, if I'm going to show somebody Richie Kotzen, I'm showing them Bootlegged in Brazil, right? Because it's live. It's not so much that it's raw, but it's this power trio format that Richie tends to play in live, and it's just spellbinding. Absolutely wonderful. And he looks the absolute business. You know, it was very much of the era, the red shirt, the leather pants, but it looked great. As a young me, getting into singing and also getting into, you know, different kinds of guitar playing that weren't Paul Gilbert. Nothing wrong with that. Love me some Paul Gilbert. That was kind of a pivotal moment, seeing that and going, oh man, you can be a great guitar player and also a singer and also a performer like that. Very, very cool indeed. So I want to know what your favorite Richie Kotzen moments are. Mark McNish says, I started looking to Richie's music after hearing some some tracks on the album you made with Adrian Smith. That is a surprisingly great album. I don't know why I'm surprised, but those guys are musically so different. I'm like, what is this going to sound like? And it came out absolutely wonderfully. If we've got any love for the Winery Dogs as well, let us know in the comments too. Quite a prolific fella, isn't our Richie? Sacred Godslayer says, I prefer the first self-titled record from Richie, the second and the stuff with Greg Howe. Now, that's stuff that doesn't get talked about quite so much because it's not really the soul end of the spectrum, let's say, or the bluesier end of the spectrum. But, you know, earlier in his career, Richie did a load of fantastic fusion and shrapnel shred type playing. I wish there was more stuff from his time with Chick Corea, because, you know, like, playing that sort of stuff, Richie is the man. Also, another really cool moment is the, talking about that sort of thing, is the solo he contributed to Erotic Cakes. So if you guys are familiar with Guthrie Govan's album, Erotic Cakes, Richie's kind of one of the only guitar players that could, in my mind at least, could kind of hang with Guthrie of that period. So that's a cool moment too. Anyway, let's fast forward a wee little bit. We got some love for the old the old Starlix tapes. Very, very cool indeed. Kim's saying, I should have dusted off my Richie Kotzen telly for tonight. Too much dust under though. I can confirm, right? I've played that guitar. Great guitar, lots of dust, unbelievable amounts of dust, but you should dust it off because it's a cool guitar, man. Hey, you know, if you don't want it, you know where you can have it live. That's what I'm going to say. Anyway, Sacred Godslayer says, listen to Saints of Arcadia. Hey, that's my band. What are the chances? Lots of Richie vocal influences too, not only the guitar. Huge, man. Richie is a massive influence for me. We've got some new music coming, by the way, just throwing that out there. It's not going to be ready anytime immediately soon because we're going to get this Blitzkrieg album out the door first, but excited about that too. We also have some cool comments from some new friends. So let's see what we got in here. Our friend Daryl M. Steven says, what's up, peeps? Daryl, it's great to have you on board, man. Thank you so much for joining us. Great to see you. Zinni with the Stripe logo says, I'll see Wolfgang VH tomorrow live. You're in for a treat, man. Wolf is on fire at the moment. We got some other stuff here. Any plans for a full-on metal player tips and tricks live sessions from someone? We should do that, you know. That's a really good idea. I'm gonna put that on the list, man. That is a great shout. Thank you very much. William Lee says, fingerstyle versus pick style on the electric guitar. Now, we'll talk about this in a minute, but I'm going to be focusing primarily on pick era Richie, but we'll be talking about some finger era stuff as well, because the finger thing, it's kind of a recent thing for our man Richie. Most of his career he's been a pick style guitar player. The finger thing, while it's a very cool development, came more recently. I also want to kind of give you guys something that you can use practically in your own playing, so we'll talk more about that. We will touch on the finger thing though as we go. Our friend Keenan Page is in the house. Keenan, it's great to see you, great to have you back. It's been a little while, man. Where you been hiding? I swapped out my SE pickups and put core pickups in my custom 24, and that has fixed all my tone problems. Man, PRS do not make bad pickups, let me tell you. Hank Staines in the house says, hi, well, I used to love Poison, saw them play in the 90s. Great talent, makes Mark Knopfler's finger picking look arthritic. It's unreal, right? Richie is a great talent. I'll totally agree with that. Also, that album, Native Tongue, man, who knew Poison had that album in them? Absolutely fabulous. Our friend, Devil Slide 01 says, even though he was around before being in Poison, that was the first time I heard him, and his tremendous vocals. The first Winery Dogs album absolutely smokes too. Totally agree. Todd S says, Richie can shred without a pick and sing like Chris Cornell. Richie is king shit. Totally agree with you there. We got some more love for metal streams as we go. We'll get onto that in a minute. Hybrid picks like no human. Yeah, do you know what it is? Like, that is another thing. Richie was the guy that got me into the hybrid picking thing. So anyway, listen, we are going to take a quick moment. I'm going to show you a course that's available on GI Plus. If you're interested in this sort of thing, here's a fun thing that you may be into. In the meantime, we're going to ask the question, right? I want to know from you guys in the comments, pick or no pick, right? So are we using a pick? Are we using no pick? We'll be doing both over the course of today's stream. But for the time being, I want to take a quick minute and show you this. If you're into the more soulful, more expressive side of the playing side, Richie's playing, or that side of the spectrum, you can check this out. This is Expressive Techniques Part 1, where you can go to learn about all of those techniques in excruciating detail. We've had loads of great results from our GI Plus subscribers who've taken this course. I'm really proud of it. It took an age to put together, but I think it's really quite something. You guys should check it out at the link down below. When we come back, we're going to be getting into the meat of today's session, starting with some note choice ideas. But first, this is Expressive Techniques, Part 1. Hi guys, Nick Jennison with Guitar Interactive and GI Plus. Does your playing sound like this? When really you'd like it to sound like this. Now, the difference between these two examples are not the notes that are being played, but rather the way the notes are being played. I'm sure you've heard this before. Guitar players will say to you, it's not what you play, it's how you play it. And when it comes to creating interesting, emotive, and musical sounding guitar lines, that is very much the case. And in this course, Expressive Techniques Part 1, we aim to equip you with the tools to sound more musical, more emotive, more interesting, and ultimately more expressive on the guitar. And we are going to do this by exploring the three principal left-hand expressive techniques, which are slides, bends, and vibrato. I'm going to show you the mechanics of these techniques and how you can execute them cleanly, efficiently, and reliably. I'll also give you some exercises to help develop these techniques. And we're also going to discuss some musical applications, how you might use these techniques in your own playing. We're going to go into great depth with that stuff. And I'm also going to give you a solo study, a piece of music I've prepared. And I'm going to encourage you and kind of guide you through the process of applying expression to an otherwise expressionless and bare sounding piece of guitar playing. So at the end of this course, you are going to be able to take otherwise uninteresting and fairly dry pieces of music and turn them into expressive, colorful, musical lines. And you're also going to be able to take this and apply it to your own playing or to other people's music that maybe you're playing and you want to express in your own way. This is Expressive Techniques Part 1. My name is Nick Jennison for Guitar Interactive and GI Plus. I hope you'll join me. I will see you in there. So that's a look at Expressive Techniques Part 1. It's one of the courses that's available as part of your GI Plus membership. Link down below, guitarinteractivemagazine.com/GI Plus. Before we get really stuck in, just want to take another quick second to shout out today's sponsors, the good folks at Tech 21. We want to shout out our friend Dale and our friends over at Tech 21 who've sent us this. This is the Richie Kotzen fly rig that we're using for our tones today. Very quickly, here's a quick thing on what it sounds like without. This is the bare amp sound. Little bit of delay, we can throw the Sans amp on and the OMG overdrive. We get this really cool thick vintage overdrive. It sounds like a blown out amp. If you've ever played an amp with power tubes that are kind of on the brink, it's kind of that feel. It's very, very cool indeed. So we'll talk more about that later. There is a full review available in Guitar Interactive magazine and on our YouTube channel. Links are in the comments. But first, let's get stuck into the meat of today's session. And we're going to begin with some note choice ideas. So first of all, what I want to do is I want to take you on a little journey from minor pentatonic to Richie Kotzen, if that makes sense. Because this is not to say that Richie never uses the minor pentatonic. Absolutely not the case. But I'm going to give you guys a very quick and immediate tip on how we can take your existing pentatonic playing and make it sound a little more Richie. So first of all, let's go to our backing track. So if you guys have your guitars, right, make sure you have your guitars with you. We're going to play together. That is my leg, by the way. I'm wearing shorts, in case you're wondering, because it's very, very warm here, right? So my hairy knee will be quite distracting as we go. I'll try and keep my knee low down so it's not the focus of the shot, but even still. So in case you're wondering what this object is right there, that is my knee. Anyway, and it's quite hairy, because I'm quite hairy. So anyway, listen, let's get into the backing track real quick. The backing track is in C minor. So I want to take a quick second and show you the C minor pentatonic position number one that we're going to be playing in, because we want this to be accessible to everybody. This is not just about the mega shredders, although we will be doing some big old shred in a little bit, believe you me. So anyway, let's begin with position number one, which is going to be based around fret number eight. We have 11 and 8 on the high E string. Same thing on the B string, 11, 8. 10, 8, 10, 8, 10, 8 on the next three strings. And then we also have 11 and 8 on the bottom. If you know other positions of the minor pentatonic scale, you are welcome to use those too. But first of all, we're just going to jam very, very quickly in the minor pentatonic, and we're going to see what comes out. Now, this is the Richie Kotzen style backing track that's available on the Guitar Interactive YouTube channel. I'll post some links in the comments as we go a little bit later on. But this is available with a bunch of other backing tracks on our YouTube channel too. You should go and check that out. So anyway, this is our C minor backing track. The way we're going to do this, I'm going to play a little bit, you're going to play back to me. We're just going to play very, very freely, and then we're going to make a slight modification that'll make things sound and feel a little bit more Richie-esque. But let's start with this. Take a turn. Isn't that great fuzzy sound? It's fantastic. All right, I'm going to take a quick pass here. You take a turn. And once we've done this, I'm going to show you a little trick that we can do to get some of that Kotzen flavor into your playing instantly, right? So we've got this under our fingers now, right? We've got this minor pentatonic thing on the go. I want to show you a trick that is quite common among, let's call them educated rock guitar players. So guitar players who maybe have, done a bit of fusion, maybe they've studied a little bit in their time, all these things apply to Richie. And what we're going to do is we're going to do a pentatonic substitution. Now the pentatonic substitution in this case is substituting C minor pentatonic rather for G minor pentatonic. So what we could do is we're not going to do this, but what we could do is we could take our C minor pentatonic, which is here, and just bop the same position all the way down here to G minor pentatonic. Which sounds fine if we play it over this track, it sounds okay. The danger with this is that because we know so many licks in the box position one of a pentatonic scale, we can wind up just playing things that are maybe a little bit inappropriate or not necessarily going to give us the results that we want if we literally just shift down this box position. I call this the Rosalie solo syndrome. So you might be familiar with the song Rosalie by Thin Lizzy. There's a great solo in there, but the song is in A major. And the solo is in A major pentatonic, but phrased as if it was F sharp minor pentatonic. So the solo goes. And it's like, well, that sounds like it's an F sharp minor. And you end up with some slightly unusual note choices. Now, we're not going to do that. What we're going to do instead of just shifting our pentatonic position down, we're going to do some slight alterations to take our C minor pentatonic and turn it into G minor pentatonic. But first, let's talk about the notes that are in there. So what do we got? We've got a C, we have a B flat, over here we have a G, an F, and an E flat. I'll say that again. C, B flat, G, F, E flat. Okay, let's play G minor pentatonic, but I'm going to start it on a C note, which is here. What do we get? We get C, B flat, G, F, D. So the only note that's different is instead of an E flat, we get a D natural. So if we take all of our E flats up here on our C minor pentatonic and we sub them out for D naturals, we get something really interesting. What we can actually play, if you're familiar with the pentatonic shapes, we could play pentatonic shape 3, which is this one. to teach you that one real quick. What we're going to do is we're going to play 10 and then 8 on the high string, 11 then 8 on the B string, 10 then 7 on the G string, and then 10, 8, 10, 8 all the way down. Now what this gives us, it gives us G minor pentatonic, but positioned. So it maps over our C minor pentatonic shape. Let me show you what happens when I start incorporating this G minor pentatonic over the course of my C minor pentatonic backing track. So I'll start in C minor pentatonic. I'll play something like this. Can you hear that? That one little trick, we've gone from pure minor pentatonic to a little bit of that Richie Kotzen goodness. Now, this is only the very tip of the iceberg, but I want to give you something that everyone can work with. So we're going to start with this as our most basic level. So let's begin by jamming again. Once again, we're in C minor pentatonic. We are going to play with C minor pentatonic, and then we're going to experiment with subbing out all of these E flat notes for D notes. Real simple. The easiest place to do it is in the high string, where we sub out fret 11, fret 10. On the G string, we sub out fret 8 for fret 7. I'm going to play, then you get a chance to play back to me. You take a turn over the cool pips. You get the big halftime section. It still works over this just fine. You can take a little bit longer. All right, so I'm gonna take a turn, we'll go quickly this time. You take a turn, and hear how big of a difference that makes, right? We're phrasing it as if it's C minor, but incorporating these D notes. Take a turn. I'm gonna show you one other note we can hit, which is gonna be kind of random here, but it's gonna sound pretty cool. Watch this. So let me show you that one real quick, right? It's another little addition that we can throw in, and we're going to talk about a broader concept with this. So what we've done here is I've taken the same idea with my G minor pentatonic, which I've expanded out into the next position up here. I'm going to show you a couple of pitches that we can throw in up top. Now we can find another B flat, which is in our scale, all the way up here on fret number, which fret number is it? It's fret number, it's not 20. Yeah, it's fret number 20. I can't count today. I've been in the sun too much. You guys can tell, right? I've changed color and everything. Pardon me. We can hit that, but a couple of ways we can make this a little more interesting is if we were to slide up and hit this with a little bit of a bend. So if we did ourselves a semitone bend, we can get these kind of really cool sounding extended sounds, but we could also then take the same idea. Instead of hitting the B flat on the top, we could hit an A, which is going to be the major six of our scale. Now, if you're familiar with mastering modes and the concepts that we've talked about in there, you'll know that this would hint at Dorian. And what you'll find with this is, because Richie's kind of so stylish with this stuff, he'll sometimes drop in some Dorian stuff where it's not necessarily super Dorian, and you'll kind of make it work. So what we can do here is we can take this same idea, we can get up, rather than getting up to fret number 20, and bending up to it, we can bend up to the pitch of fret number 19, which in this case is going to be an A note over the key of C, which gives us that. And there's an interesting implication to this in a second that we'll talk about, but let me show you what's going on with this. So you'll sometimes find this in some of Richie's more improvisational moments where he'll just reach for something that's way, way up high, and sometimes just something really cool like this Dorian A. Ultimately, with this, I guess the lesson is don't be afraid to leap. A question from Adrian Gutierrez. Adrian, great to see you, my man. How do you get such a great tone? You use one of these. This is the Richie Kotzen fly rig. You also use some of these. These are Fishman Fluence Greg Koch Gristletone P90s. You also use one of these. I'm wearing the t-shirt. You use one of these, which is a Victory Super Kraken. Those three things together. And you'll have a great tone. To be honest, lots of other ways to get great tones too, but that's a fun way. So anyway, a comment from Sacred Godslayer, a very good one here. He says, when I substitute the pentatonic, the D needs to have a resolution that the normal pentatonic doesn't need, at least to my ears. Now, this is an interesting one because, thank you. You're very welcome, Adrian. Very welcome. I think this could just be a stylistic thing. So what you'll find is that hanging on that number, that ninth note in the scale there seems to work very, very well in, let's say, more jazz-leaning styles of music. So styles of music like fusion, like soul, like the kind of funk rock that Richie is kind of known for, that really flies. However, doing it a whole lot in, let's say, heavier styles of music, so in metal, let's say, it's maybe not the move. It's a really interesting one. What I found myself is, just going off on a tangent for a moment, is the more fusion-y I tend to get in my metal gigs, the more the audience seem to switch off, especially because I play new wave of British heavy metal with my band, although we hate that term. I like it. I don't mind it. I think it's pretty cool. But Brian Ross, the singer, he hates that. I feel the more pentatonic and the more John Sykes I stay with that sort of stuff, it's kind of, people tend to respond to it a lot more. It's contextual, I think. So, you know, it's one of them things. Anyway, listen, let's expand on this idea of what we've been doing with this this pentatonic thing. So what we've done here, we've introduced a D note. We've also introduced an A note. Now these are two interesting pitches that when combined with our minor pentatonic scale, give us some modal sounds. Now these modal sounds in this case are Dorian, but you'll find it in a whole bunch of other different ways. But one interesting way that Richie accesses these modal sounds is through the use of arpeggios. And what you'll find is we're going to stick in the minor key for the time being, but there's some great examples of this in you know, some of his major key ballad type playing. You know, if you think about like the live versions of Remember, for example, there's some absolutely wonderful stuff in there. But we're gonna focus on the minor key playing for the time being because it's a little more easily accessible for everyone. What we might do is we might start using the first arpeggio, which in this case is a C minor 7, from our key of C minor, right? I'll explain all this if you're going like, whoa, wait a minute, this has gone from pentatonic to first arpeggio of C minor. Don't worry, it's all going to become clear as we go. What we can do is we can start to use some small arpeggios to create some really interesting results. So first of all, let's do some, right? So let's start with this one here. If we play in the key of C minor, we can play a C minor arpeggio that goes something like this. We can play C minor as a C, an E flat, and a G. And we can throw a B flat on up here. Let me show you that once again. So we have C, E flat, G, B flat. Now, if we were to play it from there, we'd get something that sounds like this, and we'd throw the backing track on. Sounds perfectly fine. It's pretty cool. Now, another thing we can do, though, is we can then take that arpeggio, or we can start on the third of it, which in this case is going to be E flat. From here, we could build another arpeggio, which would give us something like this. We'd get E flat, G, same notes as before, B flat, D. Now this is an E flat major 7 arpeggio. If we start here. We've got something kind of interesting, because every time we hit a new arpeggio here, we're introducing a new upper extension into the scale. We start off with C minor, which in this case is just giving us C minor arpeggio, C minor 7 arpeggio. It's still kind of housed within C minor pentatonic at this point. But as soon as we go to here, here we've introduced that new D note, which is actually where this arpeggio, this that's where that comes from. So we've got this one here. What we can then do, you guessed it, is we can then take this guy right here. Let's go to the close-up cam. We can take the second note, in this case, the major third of our E-flat arpeggio, which is gonna be a G, and we can build a minor arpeggio from there. So we've done minor, major, into the same shape as before, which gives us G, B flat, D. And then up here, we have an A, which is also from our pentatonic scale, which gives us this. Now, if we were to go a little step further with this, what we could also do is we could park another note on the top, which we're gonna do. Again, our cowcat has hit the nail on the head, the famous arpeggio from his REH video. For sure, man, this is not as extended a version of that. If you wanna go and see that, it's all available for you. But let's take a little step further. So if we take this C minor seven, and then we go to our E flat major seven, the new note we've introduced is D, and it's on fret number 7 here. Well, we could just play that on top of our existing C major arpeggio, C minor arpeggio, rather. And then we could do the same thing with the next extension, where we take our E flat major 7 arpeggio, and we throw this F note on top, which in this case is gonna give us an E flat major 9. On G, we can play G minor 9, which again gives us this note that we reached for on the top up here. And on we go. We could actually kind of continue doing this for as long as we wanted to, but what's actually happening, we're thinking about playing C minor 9, E flat major 9, G minor 9, but what we're actually getting is we're getting C minor 9, C minor 11, C minor 13, because it's all happening over this C. And if we sequence it like a crazy person, this is where the mega shred comes in. So don't worry if this is something that's kind of a little beyond your chops at the moment. You can still get some cool ideas out of this. What we might do is we might start by playing it fairly slowly. Already it sounds like Richie, but if we start to phrase it, we throw in the next lick that I'm going to show you, which is one that I play all the time. Well, we can have some fun with that. So there's endless possibilities with this, but ultimately what we can do is we can then extrapolate this out a little bit further. And we can basically think about playing arpeggios from the home key, if you want to call it that, the home key. And we can just play any of them. So, you know, if you happen to know your arpeggios in the key of C minor, just pick any of them and you can phrase through them. If you phrase through them in an interesting linear kind of way, maybe you repeat some notes, maybe something like this. Maybe don't put your guitar out of tune in the process. Let me just hit the tuner on my fly rig. Haha, handy, good to have. There you go. It's this one. as D for a change. That's much better. We can get some really cool Richie phrasing. Now, here's another thing we can do, right? We're going to get into the finger and thumb thing, I guess, for a minute, which is one of my favorite licks, right? So this is what I kind of think of as the Richie Kotzen rudiment. So you'll have seen me do this quite a lot, but we're going to begin with something kind of at the top end of our minor pentatonic scale, because this is kind of the easiest place to demonstrate it, I guess, but there's loads of ways we can do it. What we can do is if we take the minor pentatonic scale up here, we're in C still, remember? So if you're tuning in right now, if you haven't missed anything, well, you have, but you can catch it on the replay. We're playing in C minor. What we can do here is it's kind of typical if we take the top four notes from our minor pentatonic scale, kind of typical for us just to rock back and forward between these. What you'll find Richie do quite a lot is you'll find this little rudiment where he'll take the lower of a string pair and play high, low, high with some pull-offs, and then roll his finger, usually the third finger, but sometimes other fingers, to get the highest note on the next string. So what you might think about this as is 11, 8, 11, then 11 on the next string. And it's going to sound a bit like this. Ever heard that sort of phrase in Richie's playing? It all comes from that rudiment, and this was one of those things when I saw him do it, like, I was like, I'm having that. That is the greatest thing I've ever seen in my entire life. It's a bit like the first time you see Yngwie do this and you go, whew, that I'm having that. This was one of those moments. But let's talk about some places where you can get this. Tilt, Cowcat says, Tilt has a good orgy of arpeggio superimpositions. If you want to go deep, that is a really great place to do it. We don't want to get like too in the weeds with this one because, you know, I want to make this accessible to as many people as we can. I don't want to just kind of go way, way off into the dark with this stuff, but we'll get into that. But it's a great shout, right? Really cool place to go for that sort of thing. So anyway, let's take this idea of this little rudiment up here, and let's move it around a few places and see where we can get. So if we do this, instantly, by the way, the way I'm getting this, I'm picking with my plectrum on the lower string and then plucking with my middle finger on the high string. But you'd be just as well doing it thumb and finger. Either way, the middle finger is really useful because what it lets you do is it lets you mute the string that you've just rolled to, the middle finger on the right hand. So if I'm playing this, no sooner have I played that high E string note as I'm touching it with my middle finger and letting it mute, and it works really, really well. But what we can do here is we can roll around the top note, so we can go from the top note from being 11 to 10 to 8 to 10 to 11. We can reach up and get 13 if we want, so we can get this. There's our 8 down at the bottom. We can also then take that note we put here. We can make that the roll, so we could play this. We can then take that same rudiment. All I'm doing there, literally all I'm doing, is I'm taking the same idea, putting it on new string pairs. There it is on the D and G strings. Sometimes I'll pick the high string twice. That's kind of it. So what we get is we end up with something like this. So in one position, we can really, 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 really go like deep with this stuff. So really, really like in like super depth. Sorry, just for a moment there. Something stopped working and I had to check on it. And we can also do some cool stuff where we start to skip strings. So we start to move. Rather than on adjacent strings, we can move from the A string through to the G string. Also then take this and we can move it positionally up the fretboard. We can get all the way up the fretboard in whatever positions we can find. So we may go here. We may go here. Wherever you care to put this, right, this is a rudiment that you can use to your heart's content, right? It's just, it's super flexible, like really, really easy once you get your fingers around it, and you can go absolutely ham with it. So let's do a quick before and after, real quick. We've had three major tips here today, which have been for you guys out there who are just dipping your toe into this stuff. Just literally take the minor pentatonic and substitute the minor third out for the second or the ninth. In this case, it's E flat substituted out for D. What we can also then do is we can start to take some arpeggios. We can stack them from different notes within the parent scale. We can get some of that cool stuff going on. We also have this rudiment that we can play. Let's do a quick before and after. And then once we've done this, we're going to be answering some questions. So if you've got questions, drop them down below. We'd love to hear from you. So anyway, let's begin with just some minor pentatonic stuff. Let's just do the substitution. Let's do the arpeggios. Let's do the rudiments. One thing we didn't talk about is doing the rudiments with the substitution. Also works absolutely wonderfully. So guys, that's been a brief look into some real surface level stuff when it comes to the genius of Richie Kotzen, right? The guy is a wonderful, wonderful guitar player, which huge influence on me when I first came across him, right? Just like great, great player, great singer. I love his songwriting too. We're not here to talk about that stuff. Hopefully though, you guys have picked some stuff up from that that's gonna be useful for you. If you're wondering how you can get a little bit deeper into the understanding side of things with this, into like learning how the modal thing works, what notes you can choose from. Luckily, we've got a course for you on this subject. This is Mastering Modes Part 1, right? Mastering Modes Part 1, which is available also as part of your GI Plus membership. You can click the link down below, you can go get it. We're gonna be answering your questions when we come back. So if you've got questions, drop them down below. We've got about 10 minutes, but when we come back, we're gonna be talking about whatever it is you guys wanna talk about guitar related. If you've got questions, drop them down below. In the meantime, check this out. This is Mastering Modes Part 1. Modes. What are modes? How do I use them? When do I use them? Well, modes are one of the things that pros use to add excitement and color to the guitar parts, and there is no reason why you can't use them too. Now, for some reason, people, especially certain online guitar teachers, love to make modes seem complicated and scary, but I'm here to tell you they really, really aren't. And in fact, if you know the pentatonic scale, I can show you how to play modes with just two extra notes. In this course, I'll show you how to play careless sounding guitar solos using modes without any of the mystery. You'll learn how to play musical sounding solos all across the neck in any key, crucially without sounding like you're just running up and down scales. So, if you're ready to take this next step with me, click the link to find out more. So there you go, guys. That's a look at Mastering Modes Part 1. It's a course that's available to GI Plus members. go down there, get yourself the course. It's great, right? If you're interested in the modes thing, this is a perfect introduction. If you're a pentatonic guitar player, maybe you're interested in dipping your toe into modal sounds, it's a good place to go get it. Anyway, listen, we're going to be answering some questions as we go. We get some great comments as well. So Response Audio says, my B-flat major licks I stole from Wes Montgomery sound great over that backing track. Colorful. That is a really good shout, my man, actually. Really, really good shout, because the B-flat major thing, depending upon how you phrase it, can sum to... if it's kind of like a B-flat bebop thing, it kind of sums to kind of blurring the lines between Dorian and Aeolian. But if you're playing straight B-flat major, it gives you Dorian. It sounds really cool, but it also has this kind of breezy quality that we get, I guess, almost from pretending that the key of C minor that we're in is actually the 2 of B-flat, which you can do, right? You can pretend. You can solo as if that were the case, and you can get some real good stuff. Really, really good stuff. Timothy Appling says, wish you had some tablets here for the arpeggios. Maybe we'll tab them out, man, right? I may have some for you next week. Cross your fingers. I'll try and get some of that done. Because that would be cool. I agree, right? Maybe we'll get you guys some tab as we go. Adrian Gutierrez, new friend of the stream. Adrian, it's great to have you on board. First of all, some lovely compliments. I want to thank you for those. That's really, really kind of you. Says, I don't know theory, but I can pick this stuff up. To be honest, here's the deal. Theory is really interesting, it's really useful, but it's not the be-all and end-all when it comes to actually playing this sort of stuff. Oftentimes, we can learn something that is cool, and then we can figure out what it's called and how it fits contextually into the broader musical thing, broader musical landscape a little bit later on. So, you know, I wouldn't worry too much about that. What is interesting is to take this stuff and dissect it and see if you can go, okay, how does this work? How does this relate to stuff that I already know how to play? And maybe form an understanding of your own of how this kind of goes together. And then, of course, you know, you can learn the names. That stuff is really useful, right? I think it's very valuable, but I wouldn't worry about that. I don't think that's necessarily something to be ashamed of. We got some comments regarding Jason Becker as well. I totally agree with some of the stuff here. So first of all, I want to throw this up here from Sacred God Slayer. I wonder how Jason would play today, how monstrous he would be if life wouldn't have been so cruel. Man, yeah, like, I mean, what a great talent. I mean, the thing is, Jason, even in the short time that he was active as a guitar player and not as a composer, which he's still making some fabulous music today. You know, his stuff is wonderful. I encourage you to go and take a listen to it, but which I'm sure you will have, but anybody else who's watching who maybe hasn't, you should really go and listen to some of Jason Becker's compositions. But yeah, I totally agree. But even in the short time that he was active as a guitar player, he played some absolutely mind-boggling stuff. From Cowcat says, I think Jason taught Richie Kotzen his arpeggios, but unable to pick it like Becker. He added more legato to those. For sure. Now, Richie's got a very interesting approach to the old arpeggio thing, in that what he tends to do is he'll tend to sweep on the way up like this. But on the way down, he'll do hammer-ons from nowhere. Let me show you that again. So what we get is this. This one he was using a pick, by the way. And that's why we get that real interesting sound that has a particular kind of like a particular rhythm on the way up and a different kind of rhythm on the way back. With regarding legato technique, by the way, Richie also has a very interesting legato technique in where he tends to use, like, I guess you'd call them hammer-ons in descent. So instead of playing a phrase like this, do pull-offs like most folks would, what Richie will do instead, this is not all of the time, he'll use pull-offs too, but he'll do this sort of thing from time to time where he'd play like hammer-ons where I'm not actually pulling off. Let's take that as an example, this string here where we play with a hammer-on, and rather than pulling off to get the next note, he'll just lift his finger at the same time that he hammers on the next note. Do a hammer-on from nowhere. Quite difficult to do. I have to lean all the way over here to get it. So you get two me's. There's my face. There's also my face. It's a really fun thing to do as well, to practice your timing. It's not I wouldn't say it's better or worse than any other legato technique. It's useful, it's a fun thing to do. Alan Holdsworth did pretty well with it, let's just say that much. But there's been some other great players who've done it too. But Richie's one of those guys where I think about the hammer-ons and descent. That's something that he does very often. So we've got a couple of other questions coming in. Let's see. Tabs would be great, but in the meantime, a rerun is definitely necessary. Yeah, these streams are always available for you to rewatch, by the way. So if there's anything you missed and you feel like we went a little bit too quick over this, don't worry. This is being delivered live, but you can always watch it back later on, and you can watch as many parts of this as you want. So, you know, like if there's something where you go, I need to come back to that, make a mental note. You can always come back to that part of the stream. You can come back tomorrow. You can come back after we're finished. Totally your call. So, you know, this stuff will be available. It's available free on our YouTube channel. You know, we never charge for this sort of stuff. Got a couple of other cool questions coming in here. I just want to address this one really quickly, though. This is a fun one from Todd S. Says, more muscle mass in dudes that have huge hands like this guy. George Lynch, too. I've been struggling for 35 years. Here's a really interesting one. So, I'm not gonna debunk this for maybe I am, but I do totally agree. But there's a really interesting thing with Richie where if you take a look at his hands, there's a photo of them laid over one on top of the other. My hands are pretty similar in size, as you would expect from, you know, a fairly normal human, as normal as I am anyway, which is not very normal, but even still. So hands are pretty equal in size. What Richie's got going on is his left hand is noticeably larger in his right hand. Apparently, I don't know if this is just mythology or what, but apparently he had some kind of stretching routine he would do with his left hand, and he would sit and will it to grow. I've heard similar things from Steve Vai, where Steve Vai would apparently sit and will his hands to grow. Cannot confirm that this works, right? I can neither confirm nor deny. I wouldn't imagine that there's a plausible biological mechanism for willing your hands to grow, but both of these guys are world-class guitar players and both have enormous hands. Or in Richie's case, has at least one enormous hand. Very, very interesting. However, flipping this around just a little bit, with regards to muscle mass and hand size, one of the greatest legato players of all time, in my estimation, I can say he's a pal, but I can say this, one of the greatest legato players of all time is Tom Quayle. Tom has very small hands compared to, say, for example, my hands. You know, I've got much bigger hands than Tom. Tom smokes me on this stuff because Tom smokes everyone on this stuff. Another example might be someone like John Myung from Dream Theater, who plays six string bass, has relatively small hands. He's a guy who's small in stature, you know, small mitts, doesn't hold him back. I wouldn't let that be something that you hold in your head as something that's going to kind of maybe stop you from approaching this sort of stuff. You can also develop extensibility in the hands. Here's another interesting thing with Tom. Because I have quite large hands, I don't really have a very developed stretch in terms of actually being able to span my hands and move them around a bit. I can make big stretches like this, but I can't do a whole lot with it. Whereas Tom's got a fantastically well-developed left-hand stretch. Another example of this might be Sean Lane, who didn't have the largest hands in the world, but played some absolutely crazy stretchy stuff. Because, you know, like any other tissue in your body, the tissues in your hands respond to stimulus and they respond to stress. So, you know, if you're careful and you don't overdo it, you can actually learn to stretch a little bit further. Again, don't overdo this because you can hurt yourself if you go too hard too soon, but over time you can build up to this sort of stuff. So I wouldn't be super stressy about that sort of thing. I don't think the muscle mass is a huge idea, although, you know, kind of one of those things. John Five has, he has another interesting one, right? John Five has a much bigger left hand. You know, I can kind of agree on that. Oh, here's a cool tip from David Yates. You can slow down speed on YouTube for sure. You can slow down speed on YouTube and you will hear all of the mistakes and you will know that this is live, so that's fine. I can deal with that. Keith MWF says, learn loads today. Really need to retain all the info. Tabs really needed. Well, listen, if you guys want tabs, I shall provide some tabs. I'll maybe drop them in the live stream hub, which is the Facebook group where we go. We post this sort of stuff. It's kind of a chat thing. There's not a whole lot going on in there right now, but we'd like it if there's more. So maybe I'll post some tabs in there, right? You'll find a link in the in the comments to the Guitar Interactive live stream hub Facebook group. I'll probably post the tabs in there. That seems like a good place to put them, and I'll link them again next week. So anyway, listen, guys, we have got to go. I'm going to highlight a couple of comments very, very quickly here from Russ GL. My left-hand fingers are about 7 to 8 millimeters. I'm guessing longer. I think it's because of practice and playing a lot. Hey, possibly. Who knows? Just notice my left hand's way bigger than my right hand. That's interesting, man. That's fascinating. Who else do we have? Timothy Appling. Same for me. I have to change positions to cover some of those notes that Nick and the aforementioned get to without changing positions. You know what it is? There's nothing wrong with that, right? You don't get a prize for reaching the note without changing positions, right? The listener can't hear. So, you know, you only get a prize for sounding good. And even then, the prize is the pride that you get from sounding good. So, you know, I wouldn't worry about it. Again, I'm kind of taking advantage of some biological advantages I've got going on here with the long hands, the long fingers or whatever. But honestly, it's not a huge deal. I don't really do that much stretchy stuff compared to some players out there who've really got this stuff nailed, Tom being one of them. One last thing, Buckethead has also got some huge hands and fingers, plays some really cool stretchy things. For sure, Paul Gilbert too. Paul's got some of the biggest hands I've ever seen in my entire life, right? He shook my hand and it literally, like, it was like this, like his hand enveloped my hand. It was huge. I'm like, my God, that's not even funny. And the guy's like 6'4 as well. He's enormous. But also, you know, one of the great guitar players of our time. Richie, a smaller, slighter guy. But let me tell you, fabulous. Shark Guy, last question. Where's your truss rod cover? I don't have truss rod covers on my guitars. I'm forever adjusting the truss rod because I take them to different climates. So I have to take these to different places. And the truss rod always needs adjustment, so I never bother having the truss rod cover. Anyway, listen, guys, thank you so much for having me. My name is Nick Jennison from Guitar Interactive Magazine. It has been a blast. I love talking about this sort of stuff. We are back next week, as we are every week, on Monday with all manner of great guitar playing stuff. I can't tell you what's coming because we got some really great stuff, though. It's going to be electric guitars again. I'll have those tabs for you as well. Don't worry, I shan't forget. In the meantime, let's jam out a little bit more on our backing track. This is the Richie Kotzen style backing track, which I will, again, I'll post the link to in the comments. Thank you so much for tuning in. It's been a pleasure. Happy Memorial Day to our American friends. Happy Bank Holiday Monday to our British friends. Thanks for coming. Really appreciate it. I will see you guys next week. Continue to do this a little bit later on. I'm gonna go and sit in my garden, enjoy the rest of the bank holiday weather. My name is Nick Jennison, the Guitar Interactive GI Plus. This is what you get as part of your GI Plus membership. Once again, huge shout out to today's sponsors over at Tech21. Thanks for giving us this amazing flyer rig, which sounds killer. Here's a little bit of a look at what you get if you were to sign up to be a GI Plus member. See you guys next week. My name is Nick Jennison, and it's a pleasure to introduce to you GI Plus, the brand new lesson platform brought to you by Guitar Interactive. We've assembled a team of the best players and educators in the world to bring you exclusive lessons covering everything from metal to blues to fusion and everything in between. Want to level up your shred chops? Check out How to Play Fast by Andy James. Or how about Sweet Picking with Rick Graham? Or maybe country's more your bag. Well, how about a full-length exclusive country guitar course from Andy Wood? Interested in learning how to play over changes? Well, members get access to hours of exclusive lessons from fusion maestro Tom Quayle. Or maybe you want your playing to sound more soulful? Well, who better than Chris Buck to show you how it's done? Or perhaps you want to learn the secrets of the masters. Well, members get access to over 60 feature-length tech sessions where our tutors painstakingly decode the styles of players like David Gilmour, Eddie Van Halen, John Petrucci, Larry Carlton, Slash, Tosin Abasi, Paul Gilbert, and many more. You get all this along with exclusive live webinars, free backing tracks, competitions, and so much more. So what are you waiting for? Sign up for GI Plus today.